We come now to the final offering of the second season. I have often said that the parts of a performance that the audience remembers the best are the beginning and the ending. A season finale is the final note of a symphony, the final line in a book. It's the final and strongest image that the viewer will carry with them. Thus, that image should be strong, unique, and well done. So, does this episode meet those requirements? No.
You walk into this room at your own risk, because it leads to the future. Not a future that will be, but one that might be. This is not a new world. It is simply an extension of what began in the old one. It has patterned itself after every dictator who has ever planted the ripping imprint of a boot on the pages of history since the beginning of time. It has refinements, technological advances, and a more sophisticated approach to the destruction of human freedom. But like every one of the superstates that preceded it, it has one iron rule. Logic is an enemy and truth is a menace. This is Mr. Romney Wordsworth. In his last 48 hours on Earth, he's a citizen of the state, but will soon have to be eliminated. Because he's built out of flesh, and because he has a mind. Mr. Romney Wordsworth, who will draw his last breaths in the Twilight Zone.
The Obsolete Man was directed by Elliot Silverstein and written by Rod Serling. The spotlight, quite literally at certain points in the episode, shines on Romney Wordsworth, played by Burgess Meredith. Did Mr. Meredith do something really bad and Mr. Serling is blackmailing him? Why does he keep showing up in bad episodes? Once again, Meredith is the only reason this story is bearable, but I'm jumping ahead of myself. Wordsworth is a librarian. Really? Is the villain's last name Bad Guy? Anyways, he has been brought to a trial of sorts, overseen by the state's chancellor and observed by some sort of committee. Wordsworth is a member of a totalitarian state where books and readings have been banned. And so, without a job or purpose, Wordsworth is dubbed obsolete and sentenced to death.
You are obsolete, Mr. Wordsworth.
A lie! No man is obsolete!
You have no function, Mr. Wordsworth. You're an anachronism, like a ghost from another time.
I am nothing more than a reminder to you that you cannot destroy truth by burning pages.
You're a bug, Mr. Wordsworth, a crawling insect, an ugly, misformed little creature who has no purpose here, no meaning.
I am a human being.
You're a librarian, Mr. Wordsworth. You're a dealer in books and 2-cent fines and pamphlets and closed stacks and the musty insides of a language factory that spews out meaningless words on an assembly line. Words, Mr. Wordsworth, that have no substance and no dimension, like air, like the wind, like a vacuum that you make believe has an existence by scribbling index numbers on little cards.
The more I think about it, the more my head hurts. Can't he just find another job? He wasn't leading a rebellion or something. And this scene doesn't end there. It goes on for like another 2 or 3 minutes, with the Chancellor shouting randomly into the microphone, and Wordsworth defending himself by saying he's a human being, and he can't just be done away with because he has value. Mr. Serling has done so well this season, telling his high moral Aesop messages in subtle and creative ways. But here, the message is so obvious and repeated over and over that I have to assume that he was storing up all his contempt for the audience until it was unleashed in one single episode. They go on about books being nonsense and that only what the state says is true. It's so heavy-handed that if he brought the hammer down over my head any more literally, my skull would crack open. Eventually, it comes to the point of the proceedings where Wordsworth is to select his method of execution. See, the victim gets to choose his own way to die, and can make any requests as long as the Chancellor allows it. Wordsworth asks for 2 specific things. First, that only he and his assassin know the method of his death. Second, that his death be televised. The Chancellor is particularly pleased with the second request, because he thinks it'll send a message to other malcontents, and he suspects a librarian's groveling fear will make good entertainment. We then hard cut to Wordsworth in his apartment, where he's to die, and calmly waits for his time to come. A camera is installed on the wall so the nation can see his demise, and he is left alone. We find out he's also asked the Chancellor to come and see him, and he comes over and starts mocking him. And then, Mr. Meredith's performance and this next scene single-handedly save the episode from the rubbish bin.
Plead by all means. Some high state official might take pity on you.
Yes, that would please you, wouldn't it? A little abject hand-wringing, chest-pounding, falling down on my hands and knees.
Suit yourself, Mr. Wordsworth. Unfortunately, I don't have time to be entertained by them when they do come. I have another appointment this evening.
Chancellor?
Make it brief, Mr. Wordsworth.
You have plenty of time. You're not going anywhere.
How's that?
I'm afraid I haven't been very fair with you. I invited you here for a very special reason. Would you like to know the method that I've chosen for my liquidation? Well, in a very few moments, here in this room, a bomb is going off.
Very thoughtful, Mr. Wordsworth. Relatively quick and painless death.
Yes, isn't it? However, knowing that you're going to be blown to smithereens in a few moments isn't the happiest thought in the world, is it? Is it?
That depends on the individual, Mr. Wordsworth.
Indeed it does.
What kind of idiocy is this, Mr. Wordsworth? You've locked the door.
Oh, yes, yes, I've locked the door. Now, question. How does a man react to the knowledge that he's going to be blown to bits within a half an hour? Answer, that depends on the individual. So for myself, I'm going to sit down and read my Bible. It's been hidden here for over 20 years. It's a crime punishable by death. Still, it's the only possession that I have that has any value at all to me. So I'm going to just sit down and read it.
That was a legitimately good scene. The juxtaposition of Wordsworth's calm demeanor and strong tone next to the Chancellor's obvious concern worked really well. It's a simple yet effective battle of wits and wills. And of course, the Chancellor starts panicking and begging to be let out. And of course, since Wordsworth asked to have the event filmed, everyone has now seen the Chancellor of the State panic and beg for his life, whilst Wordsworth stays calm and simply reads his Bible in quiet confidence. As one final act to prove that he's the bigger man, Wordsworth unlocks the door and allows the Chancellor to escape, just as the bomb goes off and kills Wordsworth. The episode is slow, meanderous, and very overbearing, but Meredith's performance was great, and there was a very cool reversal of fortune thing going on there. It might have squeaked by with the 2 out of 3. And then the ending comes. Mirroring the opening, the Chancellor is now brought to trial for showing weakness, and the crowd of people around him apparently tear him limb from limb.
Chancellor, the late Chancellor, was only partly correct. He was obsolete. But so is the state, the entity he worshipped. Any state, any entity, any ideology that fails to recognize the worth, the dignity, the rights of man, that state is obsolete. A case to be filed under M for Mankind in the Twilight Zone.
This is such a moronically overbearing message. Yes, Mr. Serling, dictatorships are bad. Thank you for telling me that over and over again for 25 minutes straight. The memory of World War II was only 16 years old in 1961, and calling the main villain the Chancellor, I'm sure, was not lost on anyone. I won't even pretend I have any comprehension of the horrors of war or the kind of terror the world felt, but this was not the creative and interesting delivery method for such a message. Mr. Serling has always come off as contemptuous of his audience, with an air of standing above someone and looking down at them as he tells them the real way to live. And I won't argue that many of these morals need to be applied, and he often makes a good point. But the overbearing attitude of his messages need to be paired with good stories to make them palatable. And he delivers over and over again, cooking up some of the best short stories in television form I have ever seen. This is not one of those times. But one shining beacon pierces the clouds. Burgess Meredith shines in this episode, showing both his strong dramatic side as well as his more intimate and quiet demeanor. His interactions with the Chancellor are great, though too long and drawn out like much of the narrative. It's not without its merits, but it is, all things considered, a very disappointing episode to end season 2 on. Clumsy plot, silly setup, but brilliant acting. I give The Obsolete Man 1 out of 3 fedoras.